Before I ask our board member and former founder of the Asian American Asian Research Institute, Betty Lee Sung, to come up, I wanted to just take a moment to thank Mark Zolar and the New York Times Company for hosting this event. They've been extremely generous, a great supporter of diversity in the Asian American community, and I wanted to ask Mark to just say a couple of words. Mark Zolar.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you. As Joyce said, it's really an honor and pleasure to have the CUNY here with us today in the Asian American Institute. It's here at the New York Times, we thoroughly embrace diversity. It's a big part of our culture, and we're really honored to have you here with us today. In case you haven't had a chance, please do take the time out to take a look at the Pulitzer Prize Hall of Fame outside. That is the reason we come to work here every day. Now, I'm the director of diversity, sports, and help wanted advertising. So I'm on the business side. So I'm the guy here trying to raise money. But the great thing is that when you come to work here at the New York Times, and we see all those awards we got, we know that we're the backbone of helping, you know, raise the money, because we got to get paid, right? We got to come to work to get paid. But one of the things we do is that as we make revenue for the company, we give it back to organizations such as yours, and we're really honored and proud to have you guys with us today. Joyce is a great friend and a great colleague, and anything I can do for Joyce and her team is more than happy to help you. And if you have anything that you'd like to do, please do see me. Now, believe it or not, I also, in my some of my spare time, I volunteer for the, I'm on the AMBA Board of Directors. And if you don't know what AMBA is, that's the Asian MBA program. And what we're doing is that there was a black MBA conference, there was an Hispanic MBA conference, and I had the distinct pleasure of meeting Gino Wan several years ago at the black MBA. And Gino, being a Korean American, said, "Mark, I'd really like to do this for Asian Americans." And I said, "Gino, well, there's no reason to reinvent the wheel. Let's go talk to the leaders of the black and Hispanic MBAs and let's get something started." And he goes, "Mark, well, I need you to come aboard with me." I said, "Oh, great." So here we go. So he kind of roped me into it. So I give you that background because this is going to be our third annual Asian MBA. It's going to sit here in New York City. It's going to be September 8th through 10th. It's going to be at the Javits Center. What it is, it's a leadership event where you come in, you know, you hone your skills as a practitioner, in whether in the private or public sector. But here's the really great thing for all the young students: if you have nieces, nephews, kids that are graduating colleges, we get about 100 companies to come there from around the world. This isn't just for American companies; this is from companies from around the world, and we try to hire the best and brightest young Asians from around the world for these companies. So it's kind of a fun event. So I please encourage you to go on to the AMBA site and register for that. And I know, Joyce, you're going to be a big part of that. Joyce has been a big part for the last couple of years. So please come to that. And that's just a little plug for AMBA. But more importantly, thank you for your support of the New York Times. Thank you for reading us, whether it be in print or online. Now, I have a 19-year-old daughter that's in college. She's never touched a print product, but she's reading us online. Her professors are making her read it, and I'm sure that's the way the demographics of this room are too. So thanks for all your support of the New York Times. We really appreciate it, and it's a pleasure and honor to have you here today. And if you need anything, Joyce knows how to get a hold of me. I'm glad to help you in any way I can. So on behalf of the New York Times company, thank you for coming, and have a great afternoon, and have a nice weekend.
Yeah, reading the New York Times is something I did a lot of as a kid and continue to do. But at this time, let me introduce to you Betty Lee Sung. And it's really not necessary to introduce her. I think everybody in this room knows her. She's a pioneer, a real treasure for ARI. And I'm so pleased to have her here to introduce our keynote speaker. So, Dr. Sung.
Actually, I was given a big, long sheet of paper of introduction to S.B. Wu, but I threw that away. In fact, I can't even find it. And I said, there's only three things you have to remember about S.B., and that is, he was the first important elected Asian American official in the United States. As far as I remember, I think it was in 1985 or something. like
elected
that?
Elected in 84, but serving in 85.
Yeah. Okay. So he's a pioneer, and he was lieutenant governor of the state of Delaware, which was so important. And then number two, of course, he was a professor of physics at the University of Delaware. And then that can eliminate all the talk about his degrees and his academic background. But the most important thing that I think about SB is that he was the founder of 80-20. Now, we have all talked this morning about data gathering, how many voters there are, what we should do about redistricting, and so forth. But SB is a very practical person, and he is the one that says, let's do something about it. We know that even though you're registered as a voter, you don't go to the polls, you don't go to vote. And you might have redistricting, but there are conflicts within the district. And then there are so many other things that prevent us as Asian Americans from participating in the political process. And that is one of the things that I was very concerned about, is the very few Asian Americans who actually participate in the democratic process of this country. And as a result, we were discriminated against, excluded, frowned upon, ignored. Because remember, when I was teaching at City College, and we found out that at one instance, the Chinatown was the dirtiest district in the whole city. And everybody says, well, why doesn't anybody do anything? So when I confronted one of the elected officials and I said, why isn't aren't the garbage trucks coming down to Chinatown? And what was the answer? You guys don't vote. And so those are the reasons why Asian Americans should get into the political process. And another example that I always use was that in Southeast Asia, the Chinese became very, very well-to-do. They owned the rice mills, the shipping companies, the factories. They had a lot of money, and they thought they could buy their way. But the thing is, when something happened, Chinese blood flowed in the rivers. And so again, I said, we have to become part of the political process. And that's why this conference particularly is important to me and to Irie and to everybody, because we want the Asian Americans to be a part of the political process. Now, SB is going to tell you, SB Wu, Lieutenant Governor SB Wu, is going to tell you about his project, the 80-20, whereby if Asians would vote as a block, at least emulating some of the other minorities who did get into the political process, that they can make a difference. And I'm not going to steal his thunder, so I give you Lieutenant Governor S.B. Wu.
Betty, I'm so glad that you throw away whichever paper they gave you. You talked about something important, that is to vote, and you warm up this audience for me, and thank you. Lieutenant Governor, Lieutenant Governor. As Lieutenant Governor, I was in charge of weather in Delaware, and the governor was in charge of everything else. I am certainly honored to be a part of AAA, AAARI program, and I thought, I love your theme, pipeline politics. Yes, I'm so glad people like Betty and Joyce and Carol gave me the opportunity to meet up with the key players of pipeline politics in New York and its greater region. Your sub-theme is, something engagement, political engagement?
Civic engagement
for social changes, yes. The ultimate aim of politics is to cause the right kind of social changes. Coming to a program sponsored by university reminds me of my days when I was a professor. You know, I retired as soon as I reached 65. Do you know why? You know, professors don't have to retire. Well, it was because one semester I was teaching a huge introductory physics course of about 250, 300 students. And there was this big, tall student who would come to each of my lectures, sat in the middle of the front row, and 3 minutes into my lecture, he would doze off. And after a while, it began to adversely affect my morale and morale of the entire class. So I said, I'm going to have to find a way to nudge the guy a little. And one evening when I was preparing for next morning's lecture, a bright idea came to me. I went cheerfully to my lecture. Sure enough, that great big tall student came in, sat in the middle of the front row, and 3 minutes into my lecture, he dozed off. So I called on the student sitting right next to him and asked her an easy physics question, like, what's Newton's second law? And she said, F equals MA. And then I turned dramatically to the dozing student and shouted, same question. He woke up, looked at me puzzled, a little bit embarrassed, and all of a sudden his eyes lit up. He smiled and said, same answer. After that humiliating experience, I decided I should retire as soon as I can. Well, let me get to the topic. 80-20, the future of 80-20. The conclusion is very short. That depends on you. So I'm going to spend some time today to tell you about the past and present of 80-20. And you decide whether it's worthy, whether you want to support it. Let me start from the beginning. 80-20 was formed in 1998 during the height of the Asian campaign finance scandal, which New York Times termed the Asia Gate. Some of you may remember that. A handful of Asian Americans were raising money for politicians illegally. And the newspaper, the media got on it as if the Asian American, anti-Asian American community had a cabal to corrupt the American election system. And pretty soon, both parties caught on, and they competed to dissent from Asian Americans, including the Democrats. Many of you, I assume, are Democrats, right? And I used to be a Democrat, not anymore, once I got associated with 80-20 in order to be not so biased, I changed to become a independent. Also, I stated very firmly that for the rest of my life, I would not accept a federal appointment, nor ran for public office. But anyway, the Democratic Party demanded all its big Asian American givers to show, one, that they're citizens, two, their last year's tax return. I was almost certain it was illegal, but our community organizations lie quiet and didn't do anything. And that's when 80-20 was born. Like they say, when the going gets tough, the tough gets going. There are good people, so I was only one of them. Tian Changlin, you know, the then chancellor of UC Berkeley, whose name you might have heard before,
Chen Xiangmei, Anna Chenault, one of the best known Republican women at the time, someone whose name is well known in New York City at the time, Henry Tent, who was then chairman of Committee of 100, and a few others. And in fact, people like Betty and, were also principal sponsors of 80-20. So that's the past. What's the present? What's the purpose of 80-20? 80-20's purpose is very simple: to help make Asian Americans equal citizens. I will present irrefutable data to you that as of today, we are not equal citizens. We don't enjoy equal opportunity in workplaces, in very, very clear record, verified by EEOC, by the way. And how is it going to do it? It intends to do it by doing politics the American way. You use carrots and sticks. You be deeply aware of human nature. You may ask, say, how come, you know, in a great country like the USA, why would we have to rise up and defend ourselves? Wouldn't the government pay special attention to such a small minority, make sure that we get equal opportunity? You have to remember, America may have the best political system, but even the best political system are administered by human beings. Human beings are strange and funny. At times we can be extremely noble, but we have all kinds of frailties. One of the most prominent frailties is that we tend to accommodate the strong and step on the weak if we have to. Don't you forget that. That is why you need to do politics. And so, how would a small minority like the Asian Americans be able to have enough political assets to do rewarding and punishing of politicians? That's when you I really enjoyed just the 15 minutes sitting here and listening to questions and answers. We have real practitioners here in this room. Many of you actually engage in detailed retail politics as well as wholesale politics. It's important. Talking doesn't mean anything. You have to get into it, get involved. And so at the risk of boring some of you, let me explain to you the power of a block vote. Let's say Joyce and I are two candidates running after the same position. And we happen to be competing in an election district with 12 million people. And for simplicity's sake, let's say there are only two constituent groups. The large one is this, 11 million voters. The small one is this, 1 million voters. And Betty and I are both candidates, so if you are a candidate, which group would you spend your resources to court after, the big one or the small one? Most of you say, well, you don't have to think. Chase after the big one, right? That's not politics. High politics is basically mathematics. You have to figure it out mathematically, what's winnable, go ahead and do it, and get it together, and then you have the power to bargain. We are not bargaining for any special treatment. We are bargaining for equal opportunity for Asian Americans. So let's say that Joyce here is the astute politician, and I am the novice. I looked at the two numbers, 11 million versus 1 million. Of course, I chase after the big one. Although I lack political wisdom, I am pretty good in raising money, kissing babies, shaking hands. So by the end of the day before election, the community leaders in the 11 million pat me on the shoulder, SB, you got it. We will deliver for you. And sure enough, when the ballot opens, I win the large community by a ratio of 52 to 48. That's not such an outrageous number, is it? Many presidential elections has a margin of difference less than 4%. And Betty is an astute politician. She said, well, you can't just look at numbers, you have to look at their past voting pattern. If this small community is like the black community or the Jewish community, blacks deliver, brother, is that right? Blacks deliver more than 9-1 to Democratic presidential candidates, regardless who is nominated, for decades. And the Jewish has delivered 8-2. And the Jewish is so united that although they mostly vote for the Democrats, when they have to, they can organize to deliver to the other side if they really got disappointed with the Democratic government, the Democratic Party. So Betty caught it after this one, and she won this community by the margin of 80-20, our namesake, 80-20. 80-20 is not such a ridiculous number because, as I pointed out to you, Jewish community does it year after year. African Americans deliver better than 9-1 to Democratic presidential candidates for decades. So let's see. I win this particular community by the margin of 52-48. The difference is 4%. What's 4% of 11 million votes? Well, at home, I figured it out. It's 440,000 votes. Okay. And Betty, Joyce here, caught it after this little community, which delivered 80-20. And what's the difference between 80 and 20? 60. 60% of 1 million votes is how many? 600,000 votes. So when all the communities' votes added together, I had a margin of plus of 440,000. She has a margin of difference of 600,000. Joyce there wins the election. And that is the power of a block vote. When you are a small community like ours, and when we have not achieved equal opportunity as equal citizens, that is what I would recommend as your first priority. Vote according to the national group, which knows what's going on, who goes out and fight for you, and vote with them. That's only how we can succeed. Now let me tell you a little bit about 80-20. I'm going to show you our top 10 accomplishments. And after that, you decide whether you're going to, we are worthy or not worthy. Oh, I may also need to tell you. When a group of us first decided to engage upon the 80-20 initiative, we always thought, well, you know, all these theories, people are not interested. If we show that we can deliver for the community, then the community will respond. Well, in 10 years, you look at it to see if we have delivered or not. But the community really has not responded. You know, being engaged in politics is much more than just getting dollars and cents for you guys or a little better equality for you. It is also to get all of us to get off that political apathy. If we completely failed in getting the community to respond, then either what we have delivered is not worth it, or we at least failed in the major portion of it. That is to get our folks to be off that apathy. And so in 2 years, if we either double our membership or we're going to disappear from the earth quietly, If we disappear, it's our fault. If I stand here, can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, good. So, skip to the next one. Table of contents, it starts from fairly simple things like stopping a TV ad. Oh, okay, thank you. And going to the big things that affect 3 million Asian American workers working in private industries and universities. That was way back in year 2000. Have you ever heard of the Daisy TV ad? Those of you who are really in politics may know about it. It's an ad that was first ran by Lyndon Johnson against Goldwater. And basically the ad shows a little girl having a daisy in her hand, taking off the paddle, counting down 10, 9, 8, and then a flash and nuclear mushroom. Okay. After it aired, the nation was indignant. Democratic Party got a whole lot of the criticism and they pulled it. From what I have researched now, it's 3 days. Some said it was even faster. Well, in year 2000, the Republican National Committee, and I'm going to say something bad about the Republican Party, as I already did, saying something bad about the Democratic National Committee. Just tell it as it is, wherever the fault lies. They add a Daisy ad that begins with a sentence, Clinton and Gore, in order to get Chinese money, shipped high technology to China. And then the little girl taking off the flower petals, flash, nuclear mushroom. And New York Times actually reported it because, wow, you know, you actually re-air such things out of completely almost without any grounds. I invited Committee of 100, OCA heads, to go with me to make a protest. They didn't want to, so I did it all by myself. I called, 8020, called the then chair of Republican National Committee, say, if you don't take off this ad tomorrow, we're gonna be against you from here to eternity. The next day, they pulled it off. So 80-20 at least dares to go where others hesitated. Oh, you know, I've never heard of Abercrombie and Fitch being old. But young folks probably know all about it, right? Abercrombie and Fitch. In 2002, Abercrombie and Fitch produced 4 t-shirts denigrating Asian Americans. One has a caricatured face with slanted eyes and rice paddy hats, and with these words, Warm Brothers Laundry Service, two wands can make it right. And another one talks about Buddha and compare Buddha to one's bud, and I forgot what it says. But anyway, it's obviously denigrating Asian Americans. 8020 got lots of emails from university students saying that, hey, we've protested, they ignored us, you guys gotta do something. So on that day, we had a meeting of the board, and I was authorized to call the CEO of Abercrombie and Fitch. You know, politics involves threatening. But if your threat doesn't work, you have to back it up. That's why we had to have a board meeting. I call the CEO, who happens to be out. So they said, can you leave a message? So I said, hey, so-and-so, you know, we got a problem. Let's work it out. Like, two CEOs trying to solve a common problem. Your T-shirts are really getting our community unhappy. I hope you will enjoy it. And I said, you know, to show you how angry our community has become, we have an email list at the time of 800,000 Asian American families and individuals. We will send out an email tomorrow if you don't withdraw it, and urging people to stop buying your product. And I said, every year from here on the same day, we will send out an email to remind people not to buy your product. I said, please think it over, call me back. If you don't call me back, I got the message, I know what to do. Hung up in 3 hours, Abercrombie and Fitch COO, Seth, that's all I remember. Do you remember the name? Seth Johnson, right. Call me back, and we're going to have a press conference this afternoon in San Francisco to announce that we will withdraw the product. Now, please understand, in politics, if you want to achieve unity, you got to realize that success have 1,000 fathers, and so just because we are the only one who got the call from ANF, it doesn't mean the other people have not helped. All others have helped, but we stuck our neck out, took the national leadership, and got it done. Third, you know, Asian Americans are not that sophisticated in terms of understanding politics. I don't mean the people in this room. I know you have real practitioners and experts in this room. But there is little understanding of how politics works. When in year 2000, Gore committed to 80-20's request in writing, we always said, hey, we don't want anything in verbally. We always want it right in writing, and we want it signed. And but Bush refused. So we have no choice. We called it, actually, we gave Bush more time because we know Republicans are more hesitant to do such things, while Democrats have done it all the time. So we know we have to understand the background. But given that Bush firmly refused, and we endorsed Gore and delivered, you'll see the numbers from New York Times poll, exit poll, for Gore. At that, before the voting has occurred, you can see in newspapers, in Chinese newspapers and Korean newspapers, saying that 80-20 is putting all the eggs in one basket. They're going to cause disaster for us if Bush wins. Well, indeed, Bush won. And you know what happens? Bush won and appointed the historic first Asian American full-fledged cabinet secretaries. Prior to that, near the very end of Clinton's administration, Clinton appointed Norman Mineta as an acting cabinet secretary, but not a full one. And so instead of causing disaster, whenever politicians know that you guys are organized, the politicians will pay more attention to you. Let me give you a personal example. I was elected lieutenant governor. So that night, I made my victory speech, go up to upstairs of DuPont Hotel, and my aide immediately handed me a piece of paper with names and telephone numbers on it. On top of it is a name like John Dombrowski. The aide would say, Lieutenant Governor, he can call me Lieutenant Governor by that time. He said, Lieutenant Governor, while you're winning the state by something like a few small votes, but this Polish district, this guy who's used to be a Democrat, but he worked against you, and he delivered something like with a margin of difference of 10 points to your opponent. Want to give him a call? I said, sure. So here, the first person I make a telephone call to after my victory was a person who worked on the other side who's very effective. And when the line got connected, I said, John, this is SB. Long silence. What's happening? Why should SB be calling me now to threaten me? I said, it's unfortunate that we misunderstood each other. Now that I'm elected, I'm still fairly young. I hope we can work, get to know each other more. May I buy you a breakfast in the green room in DuPont Hotel tomorrow morning? Now, that's the political lure. If you were John Dombrowski, would you want to resist it? He said, wow, everyone in my neighborhood knew that I worked against SB Wu. And the morning after his victory, he's having breakfast with me in Green Room, which is a power room in Delaware, in DuPont Hotel. So understand what's politics. The key concern of every politician worth his or her soul is the next election. It's only in China that you have one guy who gets the power that stays on forever, forever, and he punishes everyone else. It doesn't work that way in USA. In USA, people think, the politicians think, the next election. So when your cause is right, fight. Don't get scared. Too many of us are too timid. Fight. If you're right, then fight. Okay. So, we delivered the first block vote ever to the wrong guy, but we got something for the community. To the wrong guy, according to people who don't understand politics. It's getting organized that serves the serves the community. oh, too bad. Those of you who are practitioners must have heard about the glass ceiling above our head for such a long time, right? And no one has actually gathered the data to show that here are the numbers. It's not talking about one little area, one little industry. We are talking about nationwide statistics. Well, we got it together and bought a full-page public service ad from Washington Post. And let me just summarize the data for you. Basically, in private industries, Asian Americans have only 52% of the national average of how all other Americans have been promoted to management. In universities, the bastion of liberalism, we only have 40%. In federal government, which is always talking about, oh, you got a diversity, stick up for minorities, we only have 33%. All these data are verified by EEOC. So now you get to understand, talk doesn't mean anything. It's power. What's African Americans' chance in universities and federal government? Their chances of rising to the management is better than the white male, believe it or not. You guys are good. You guys know how to demonstrate, got to get things together and fight, right? And we are timid. We don't dare to fight. So we bought the full page ad, and now that becomes anyone that wants to talk about equal opportunity, can get on the web and see the data. It's all proven, data are all from government. And let me also remind you that there are statistics searching about what the education background of different races. Who do you think has got the most educational degree achievement? I can say, only say, because education does not necessarily prove ability, right? But in terms of degrees, of course, Asian Americans. Asian Americans has almost twice as many PhDs than white, percentage-wise. Much more in bachelor's degrees, even in terms of bachelor or in master's degrees and in professional degrees such as architect, blah, blah. And even in bachelor's degrees, Asian Americans is better than the white male. In terms of comparing with other minorities, Asian Americans per thousand persons wise have much, much more. So in spite of very high educational attainment, the chance of rising to management is so much less. And that is, if you ever question that, ask me, I'll send you. Oh, by the way, I would love to interact with you practitioners more. I hope to get your email addresses and perhaps even get you to join 8020. But I want to get you the site so that you can find these statistics, never been disputed. Oh, so how does Blockville work, right? Well, we caught the Republican Party a great deal because we realized that if we can get both Democrats and Republicans competing to serve our rightful interests, that is the only way of winning it. If we only get one side and not the other, that's problemsome. I know Jesse Jackson quite well. Jesse Jackson told me, SB, I can never threaten the Democratic Party to say that I'm going to swing my guys to vote for the Republican Party. They won't believe it. He said, the only way I can affect their mind a little bit by saying, if you are not willing to do this, then people like me and my associates are going to sit this election out. Now, why is that an important threat? Because blacks deliver 9-1. If you can deliver a margin difference of 9-1, the larger the number of African American turnout, then the larger what? The difference it makes, right? So we know about the defect of being connected to one side only. Look at the Jewish Americans. They're much more politically powerful. So we hope to hook in with the Republicans, and we are getting there somewhere, but by that time, we still have not. How many of you have heard of Elaine Chao? Raise your hand. Elaine Chao's got a big title. Is she a heroine for our community? I'll say no. She was a Secretary of Labor who's in charge of enforcing Executive Order 11246. Many of you have never heard of that law. That's fine. It is basically the law that gives affirmative action the teeth. Okay. We're trying to talk to Elaine Chao. She and I both used to belong to Committee 100. I said, Elaine, African American young, Asian American youngsters have to meet higher admission bars to getting to the university because there are too many already. Well, maybe so, we can understand that. But on the other hand, Asian American adults being so few among the management lectures are not given any advantage in affirmative action. How come? You have the power to enforce it, why don't you do it? She would not recognize that fact and she will not do it. So to me, please, friends, don't worship title. Only respect what people have done if they do the right things. If you worship title, you know what would happen? Every one of his politicians will gun after title, ignore serving you. That's a natural result, right? Because you only respect me if I have a big title. So please resist that feudal Chinese, or actually Asian, impulse. You got to say, what have you done for me? Are these the right things? If the person has done the right things for you, then respect the person. Title means nothing. And if you don't listen to what I do, then you get what you deserve. Oh, so you may remember in 2006, there was a big congressional election. It's an off-year election. That's when the Senate and the House changed hands from Republicans to the Democrats. And we were so mad at Elaine Chao and Bush for completely ignoring such irrefutable evidence of inequity towards Asian Americans. We decided for the first time to get into congressional election. In the past, we've only gotten into presidential election. And one election in Virginia, a Democrat, Webb, he won. Remember, his opponent said something nasty about a Indian American. He won by that many votes, 7,000 votes approximately. And according to CNN's exit poll, 3% Asian Americans voted in that election, and voted by a margin of 68 to 30. You know, our namesake is 80-20, so we didn't quite do that, but it's getting close. And a 35-point advantage, you can do the mathematics and see. If we didn't endorse Webb, he wouldn't have gotten elected, and Democrats would not have gotten the control of the U.S. Senate. But more than that, to the Republicans, say, ah, my God, we really shouldn't make those guys that mad. If we didn't, we would have maintained our Senate leadership. That's what politics. It is carrots and sticks. You gotta be able to reward and punish. Am I bullshitting? Well, here are the results of Asian American voting records. It's New York Times exit polls, which is the same as CNN, by the way. In 1996, Clinton, Doe, others, we voted roughly 50-50. It's 43-48, a difference of 5 points. By Gore, that's when 80-20 has organized itself. Gore, Bush, although Gore lost, but Asian Americans voted 54-41, a difference of 13 points. By Kerry's time, Kerry, Bush, 56-17, a difference of 12 points. We didn't go all out for Kerry. Why not? Kerry made us a promise. Small little thing. Welch on it. And we immediately publicly stated we will withdraw half of our money that's reserved to help his election. We let him know about it. By the way, what kind of bad consequences could there be? Well, I'm still standing here, right? And I'm not rich, but I'm not poor either. There is no bad consequences. This is America. This is democracy. You have the right to exercise how you vote, how you call for things. And by Obama and McCain, Obama, we worked our hearts out for Obama, especially in the battleground states. We hardly work here, because there aren't that many Asian American votes. You have 6% of the population, but I think you probably only deliver 1% of the Asian, 1% of your state's votes. Now, there are experts in here who know better numbers. If I'm wrong, correct me later. We deliver plus 27, and we have not decided what to do with Obama this time yet, because we have another set of questionnaires for Obama if he replies right as compared to the answer from the Republican nominee, then we'll help him again. But it is politicians think next election. We are in politics. We think next election. Every election is a golden opportunity for us to get a bit more equal. The promise from Obama, some of you knew we fought very hard for it, to the point that we actually did call to action, defeat Obama. Nothing's happened to me either. These three questions were about federal judges. You know, Asian Americans represent 4.5% of the nation's population. We have a disproportionately larger percentage of lawyers, many of whom are Ivy League school graduates. But guess what fraction of our federal judges are Asian Americans? 0.7%. And so we want Obama to promise that he'll give, what's the exact word we use? Top priority. Anytime there is a federal judgeship open at the district court level, and then the next question is about appeals court level, the third question is about Supreme Court level. That was an easy question. We just say, would you consider appointing? Because we don't have the folks that's qualified at this point. But you know what happened. Now Obama got elected. We used to have 6 judges, entire nation, 6 Asian American district court judges, all at the lowest rank. Guess what's the number today? 13 plus 2, more than double in a few short years, all coming out from that promise. And every politician refused to answer yes or no, because that binds them. There's no leeway to it. They all want to give you long sentences. Oh, I respect Asian American culture. So many of my staff are Asian Americans. I go to a community affair all the time. Nothing. They don't mean a thing. So your program sheets are often surfaced by this mayor, this governor congratulates you for this meeting. Why, as intellectuals, will we do such stupid things? They're completely meaningless. And the next 3 questions are about equal opportunity in workplaces. As I said, these basically says, will you enforce Executive Order 11246 for Asian Americans? And would you have a meeting with us next year at the White House to review how much progress has been made? And by the way, Biden, Hillary Clinton all gave the same promise, all in writing, all signed. See the signature right here? I already stated we've doubled. What's 13 plus 2? 2 means now we have 1 confirmed appeals court judge and 1 that's yet awaiting Senate confirmation. The last one is really the most important thing, although I can see my time is slipping away. I'll just summarize it this way. See the words, stars are aligned. We spent basically 80% of time working on this issue. Why? Because it affects 3 million Asian Americans. Judgeship is important. It may affect something like 10,000 Asian American lawyers and benefits a few people who got appointed. Very small number, doesn't mean much. But this affects every Asian Americans who don't work in ethnic towns, who don't work in Chinatown, Japantown, blah, blah, blah. The result of today is that Hilda Salas is the labor secretary. You might have never heard of her, but she is, her parents used to be immigrant workers, very sympathetic to the problems faced by immigrants. Of all the secretaries, you think we must have worked on guys like Gary Locke and Steve Chu. No, we didn't spend that much time working for those guys. The one secretary position we focused on was labor secretary. That has to be the right person. It cannot be another Elaine Chao. Patricia, who in labor department enforces Executive Order 11246? It is an organization called OFCCP, which stands for Office of Federal Contract Compliance Program. That person is the person who decides that, hey, if company A is not really not dealing with African Americans or Asian Americans correctly, that person can decide. Therefore, federal contracts for that company will be canceled. That is the power of Executive Order 11246. It can take money away, money talks. So she is a Chinese-American female lawyer known for her liberalism in California. Betsy King, a Korean-American, is a White House liaison stationed at DOL. Chris Chu, a name whom you have not heard of that much, a person with huge power. His formal title at the White House is that he's the cabinet secretary, which means he is between Obama and all the cabinet secretaries. Many smaller departments usually report to him first before it goes to Obama. And his salary is the same as that of chief of staff of White House. And we are meeting with Obama early next year. So this is what 80-20 does. And instead of going over time, I would like to quote you something I like, because there are so many people who are activists in the pipeline politics. I would like to quote Theodore Roosevelt. The critic doesn't count, not she who describes how the mighty had fallen, how the doer of deeds could have done them better. Credit goes to she who is actually in the arena, which many of you are, whose face is marred with dirt, sweat, and blood, who tries valiantly, who comes up short time and again. All of us who work in practical politics knows that we have failed so many times. And then I'm going to skip a few lines and go to the very end. But just at least better than those timid souls who know neither defeat nor victory. Well, thank you very much.